has four games going on at one time. He's got a game going on with the opponent.
Screaming and yelling all the time when he makes a shot.
He's got a game going on with the referees. He's got a game going on with the people sitting in the second and third row.
This is too much. He is unbelievable.
He had to have a blood transfusion when he was about 3 days old. Sometimes I wonder what kind of blood was in the transfusion.
All I need is a little tight dress, some red lipstick, and some pumps. I'll be all right.
He loves to shock people. It's all part of bad boys getting more attention than good boys.
Why don't they just take their ass whipping like people and go home?
No, you know, I never got the impression that Charles Barkley liked to shock people.
Dreams come true in my new shoe. That's not what I want to say.
Charles's honesty may be one of his downfalls. I mean, one of the reasons that he gets in trouble is because everything he says is honest.
But ain't no one player can guard me, and y'all can write that down.
He's a free spirit. He's John Wayne in shorts.
Ho, brother!
God want us to win the world championship.
I don't know if I go that far, Charles.
Oh, no. I talked to him the other night.
If you listen to Bark and you shut your eyes, you think there's a young Cassius Clay out there ready to jump out of that skin.
I still don't quite have the answer. Maybe he said it right. He's the ninth wonder of the world. He says that he's God's chosen one. It might be tough to disagree with both of those.
Somebody has to be me. It might as well be me.
When trying to explain Charles Barkley, it seems that no single image is enough. But despite all of the descriptions that have been offered, there is one that is rarely heard.
He was a very shy kid. You know, he was just, he was quiet. I mean, he was.
Though this may seem hard to believe, growing up in tiny Leeds, Alabama, that's how Charles Barkley was known.
He was on the chubby side, and he was just about as chubby, as tall as he was chubby. And the kids used to pick at him.
Raised by his mother and grandmother, young Charles was not only quiet, but also unusually mature.
He was a father to his younger brothers, you know, because he grew up without a father.
I would work two jobs, and I would get up so early sometime in the morning time to leave home, I wouldn't have time to do anything. But by the time I got home from that second job at night, the house would be clean as a pen.
My mother cleaned houses, and my grandmother worked at a meat factory. They did whatever it took to make sure that we had something all the time. We didn't have a lot, but we never went without. So that's probably the greatest thing that I learned from him, just do whatever it takes to make yourself successful.
With that lesson in mind, Charles began to play basketball, not only with thoughts of fun and games, but also of his future.
In high school, my number one priority in life is to make life easier on my mother and grandmother. So I'm thinking, just go to college for free, because if I didn't get a scholarship, I wouldn't have been able to go to college.
But as an overweight 5'10" guard, Barkley didn't appear to be a likely target for college recruiters.
His height, it's just hard for him to compete. Plus his shot in high school wasn't that good. Charles was so average.
Despite his obvious shortcomings, Charles remained determined.
You know, a lot of Saturday nights when the other boys would be out going to dances and things, Charles would be down on the basketball court, right down the street, bouncing a basketball.
Charles's skills were improving, but it didn't really seem to matter.
He would come home and he would cry sometimes. He said, Mama, I am good enough to play on the varsity team if they would just give me a chance. His granny would tell him, just keep working, baby. If you got it, somebody's gonna see it.
Clinging to this hope, Barkley struggled in vain to overcome his physical limitations. And then, as if to reward his faith, Providence finally lent a hand.
He started to get bigger and bigger and taller and taller.
Everybody was like, hey, come down to the gym. Charles Barkley can touch the rim and slam a basketball. And I thought, there's no way Charles Barkley can dunk a basketball. He's 6 foot.
Barkley's surprises were just beginning. Shooting up in height, he would finally have a body that was a proper vessel for his determination.
Between my junior year and senior year in high school, I went from 5'10 to 6'4. Even though when I had the growth spurt, I was never really awkward because I had been playing guard all those years, and all of a sudden, everything just fell perfectly into place.
It would not be long before Barkley began catching everyone's attention.
You know, and God is good. He just happened to be in the right places at the right times, and the right people were in the stand, and they seen him play. They said, where they been hiding this kid?
Charles finally had his chance, and he wasn't going to blow it. He would make Leeds High School one of the best teams in Alabama. But more importantly, he would reach a goal that only months earlier had seemed impossible. He earned a scholarship to Auburn University. One phase of his life was ending, and another very different one was about to begin. The Charles Barkley who arrived on the campus of Auburn University in the fall of 1981 bore little outward resemblance to the one who had left tiny Leeds, Alabama. Over the summer, he had grown in both size and athletic ability, and now, away from the domestic responsibilities of home for the first time, he was feeling his oats.
I would not let him break the breakaway rims down. And he would, every time he would dunk, he would break that rim down and look at me like, what are you going to do about this, sonny? And I said, now if you break the rim down one more time, you're out of here. And naturally, he's going to do that. He broke it down and I ran him out of practice.
If Charles was causing a stir on campus, it was nothing compared to the impact he had once he took the court for the Auburn Tigers.
Watch Barkley moving underneath them, always in motion.
Oh, there goes Barkley. Look out for this one. Here comes Barkley.
Are you kidding me?
I've never seen anything like that in my life.
Are you kidding me?
And threw it away, Barkley with a great anticipation. Look at the big guy move. Do you believe it? Barkley.
He could do things you couldn't believe.
Barkley, my goodness.
This is Fetterman inside, blocked by Barkley.
The big guy has turned the game around.
No question about it.
Well, go, there's Barkley again.
He lights up the joint. What a player.
He was just overweight and didn't look like he was in condition. But once the ball was thrown up and the game began, it was a scary situation.
Man, Barkley just hit the deck and he drew an offensive foul. They're going to call it on Bowie.
Incidental contact with that guy over the speed limit could give you a terminal whiplash.
He got to like 310 pounds. I mean, the guy was just mammoth. I mean, he was definitely a man child.
It's a race now, but Barkley's back. Watch him go up. It's phenomenal talent. Long lead to Barkley, and he's fouled down low. You're talking about box office and marquee value.
Barkley's a PR man's dream. He has charisma.
With his gigantic frame and his explosive style, Barkley attracted attention everywhere he went. And the unheralded Auburn basketball program quickly seized this opportunity to gain national exposure.
We were getting attention out of the fact that Charles was so heavy. And I think we worked hard to get publicity any way that we could. And that was one way to get it. We were selling fat, we were selling anything. And Charles was a sellable item, he really was.
Hello, I'm Charles Barkley, Auburn Tigers. PR Field, my nickname. The Bread Truck, the Love Boat, Food World, the Frisco Kid, which is my second favorite. The Wide Loathing League, Town of Fun, the Good Time Blimp. But my favorite is the Round Mound, the Rebound.
Charles had grown from a shy and responsible kid into a brash media sensation.
I was always really quiet. And then when they put you in the limelight at the age of 18, you go to college, everybody knows you and everybody's talking to you all the time. Your personality changes.
And the true measure of that change was evident in his growing conflict with his coach, Sonny Smith.
He was lazy and he felt like he could play real heavy. And I felt like he couldn't. So we had a little war going there to lose weight.
He could have said to me, Charles, you need to lose some weight and you can play better, instead of saying I was a fat, out of shape slob all the time.
I knew I had something special. I knew I had a pro on my hands. And I knew that it was my responsibility to develop him, give him a chance later. So I was really tough on him.
At the end of my second year, I'd had enough. I had led the SEC in rebounding 2 years. I was all SEC, and he was still riding me all the time. So finally, I just picked up and said, hey, I'm transferring.
Charles Barkley had reached a crossroads. In his struggles with Coach Smith, he faced both the benefits and the burdens that came with his newfound stardom. And his resolution of this conflict would set a pattern for the rest of his life.
We had a meeting, and we sit down, and he said, hey, you lose a little weight, you'll play harder, you'll play better. And he was right. And I told him what I expected from him, to treat me like a person. I knew right then that I wanted to be treated like a person, not just a piece of meat.
Charles would stay at Auburn for his junior season, and it would be his best. He would be named SEC Player of the Year and lead Auburn to its first ever NCAA tournament appearance. And as he made his decision to forego his senior season and enter the NBA, he looked forward to a bright professional career and looked back with new perspective.
I had matured from my freshman year. Well, I just rebelled. My sophomore year, I just rebelled. But by the end of my sophomore year, I knew that I wanted more, expected more. I became a person who could speak for themselves. Just grew up from a little kid to a man.
With his final season at Auburn, Charles had established himself as one of the most talented players in college basketball. But questions about his attitude remained. And despite his impressive showing at the Summer Olympic trials, he found himself cut by strict disciplinarian Bobby Knight.
I had no real interest in playing on the Olympic team in 84. No disrespect to anybody. I just didn't want to play basketball all summer.
Despite Barkley's questionable reputation and his recurring weight problems, the Philadelphia 76ers made him the fifth pick in the 1984 draft. And as he began his rookie season, Charles quickly displayed the ability that had caught the Sixers' attention.
It was just his amazing strength and explosiveness, even at that time, weighing around 280 pounds. And you'd say to yourself, wow, this guy could be, you know, something special.
But though Charles played with raw passion, he seemed unable or unwilling to discipline his talent.
Charles's first year was quite an experience. Charles would act up. Charles wouldn't run back to half court. Charles was very difficult, to say the least.
It seemed as if Charles had once again fallen into the rebellious trap that he had struggled through at Auburn. But now, he would have veteran center Moses Malone, one of the NBA's hardest workers, to provide him with an example.
You could see that Charles wanted to be great, but he didn't want to work at it. So I said, Charles, you know, things you got to do, it's not going to come easy, because right now you're into pro ball, you got a lot of great athletes. So what you got to do, get the attitude and get mean and get aggressive and come play every night.
Under Moses' tutelage, Charles learned to tap his vast well of natural ability.
Up until then, I had never worked hard. I just played the game strictly on talent. He taught me how to work hard. I got in really good shape, and I'm just watching him and learning from him.
As he began his second season, Barkley saw Moses' lessons begin to pay off.
He's alive. Barkley's there. Gets it again. Reverse left hand by Barkley.
Here's a bad pass. It might get out of hand. Not before Charles gets it.
Just a question of Charles wanting it more than Dan Brownfield.
He got believing in himself and got believing in what he could do. And he went to another level.
Just as Barkley was beginning to mature as a player, however, he would be thrust into a demanding new role.
At the age of 24, the mantle of responsibility had fallen on him. Doc was gone, Moses was gone, Bobby Jones was gone, and it was Charles Barkley's team.
It was a challenge that stoked Barkley's competitive fire. Responding with a vengeance, he would take his game to another level and take the league by storm.
Charles just taking over now.
Oh, what a pass.
Oh, that's the pass of the year.
That's the finish.
Got a finish.
Oh, what a rejection by Barkley. What a play.
Comes Charles.
Down the lane. Goodbye.
physical. The guy's just relentless.
So here's Barkley now, going to go in by himself.
Gets the offensive rebound and slams it.
I think he intimidates everyone.
Barkley, the move, and a foul.
He's just unstoppable.
Bull taps it once and can't make it. Charles looks like he's just determined to take over this game about as authoritatively as you can. He went. Whoops. The sucker play by Barkley. Does it work? Yes!
Charles was now dominating opponents and doing it in an entirely new way.
Charles is on the run again. 2-on-2. Wow. Right by Ellis. Oh.
Here you had a power forward in a small forward's body with guard instincts, and there's never been a player that I can remember that combined all of that.
Barkley had become one of the league's marquee stars, and no one was enjoying it more than Charles himself.
Charles is a fun-loving guy, and a big part of his success, I would say, is fueled by emotion.
That's what I'm talking about, the ultimate entertainer. That's what he can do best.
He is really a different guy. His elevator doesn't always go to the top.
Both on and off the court, Charles was now the center of attention.
Me. Forest High State Cat.
This is called Yay, Alabama. You go roll to victory, pitch is tried. Your dick is whipped by pride, Crimson Tide.
Charles, at heart, is an entertainer. He enjoys being in the limelight. He enjoys being a celebrity.
Comedies winds up in the cheerleading section, and Barkley, too. He doesn't want to get up.
He's an intelligent man.
And whether he was playing to fans or reporters, he rarely disappointed.
What's the most important thing you have to do next game?
Score more points than they do.
All you have to do is ask Charles Barkley a question, kickstart him, and he's on his way, and he's honest.
Well, we don't have a lot of plays. All the plays we got is get the ball to me somehow.
Well, the NBA sent us a rule today that says anytime we foul anybody delivered it too hard, we're going to get ejected from the game, so you're safe. Good.
With his no-holds-barred approach to celebrity, Charles had become one of the most distinctive superstars in all of sports and had achieved a level of fame that even he never dreamed of. But with all of his accomplishments, there was still something missing. Since taking over the team's reins, he had been unable to find postseason success. It was a void that had begun to take its toll.
Charles cares. Despite all of that outward bravado and all the charisma that flows out of Charles, within is an intense athlete who cares, who has pride, who wants to be successful.
And as the 1990 season began, it was clear that Charles was more determined than ever to bring playoff glory to Philadelphia.
He wanted the game on his shoulders. He unlike some other players that that aren't comfortable with the chips on the line and the gun staring at them, he thrives on that.
7 seconds left. Charles is going to drive from there. Little 18-footer. Go! What a play by Barkley.
There were games when he needed to stop people and play good defense. He did.
Dominique Wilkins to the other end. Spin move. Scoop shot. Offensive foul. Philadelphia has the lead on the ball with 3 seconds left.
But as important as his personal heroics was his ability to instill the team with his own spirit.
His desire to win made me get it, and then we started having a lot of fun winning, and then in turn winning, you act like a kid, you have a good time.
Did he finish that baby or what? And Charles just in ecstasy.
Barkley, 1, 2, 3, triple bogey. And a foot stomp.
Ah, when you're winning.
Yes, sir.
Feeding off Barkley, the Sixers ran roughshod over the league and enjoyed doing it, piling up 53 wins and capturing the team's first Atlantic Division title in 7 years. They surged through the season on an emotional high.
Sixers will set up for the final shot. AC Green and Charles Barkley. Charles with room. Yes, score it, and a foul.
And as they entered the postseason, Barkley's sights were set on nothing less than a march to the finals.
He felt at that time that that was the most talented team that he'd had around him, and this was his chance to in Philly to get there.
In the first round, the Sixers began their playoff quest in style.
3-on-2.
as Barkley led them past the talented Cleveland Cavaliers.
Here goes Charles. Great play.
That'll do it. This team is too good to worry about one series. We're going to Chicago feeling like we can win.
Confidently heading into the second round, Barkley and the Sixers looked forward to facing another up-and-coming young team. A victory against Michael Jordan's Chicago Bulls seemed like it would be the perfect stepping stone to establishing the Sixers' supremacy in the East. But it was not to be. Ambushed by a Chicago team that seemed suddenly to be coming into its own, the Sixers would manage to win only a single game.
Takes it all the way to the rack.
Barkley's high hopes had been dashed, and Charles himself was left all but brokenhearted.
I'm disappointed and frustrated right now. I mean, I can't even put it into words how bad I feel right now. I mean, it's that bad. You know, most of the people out there, they don't understand. They think it's just a game you play. This is your job, and you really care about winning and losing.
Chicago would go on to win a championship the very next year, but Philadelphia would never recover. Injuries and ill-fated trades would disband the group of players that had achieved such special chemistry, and Barkley could only watch in frustration.
You know, we were only a player or so away from really being able to challenge the whole thing, and before that could happen, that team was dismantled, and I think that really bothered him.
Barkley's emotional slide was just beginning. The Sixers began to lose with regularity, and Charles's playoff dreams seemed further away than ever.
I could see the frustration in him as the year went on because he felt that, you could see it, that the opportunities were dwindling away.
And Charles was typically candid with his emotions.
There was a game at the Forum against the Lakers, and the Sixers lost badly. And after the game, Charles said, "We got a bad team." Now, so that there could be no misunderstanding, I posed the question among a group of reporters. Do you mean that you have a team that didn't play well tonight? And he looked us all in the eye and said, "No, man, we got a bad team."
Charles's honesty, which had always seemed so engaging, now was working against him.
You know, when you're losing and when you're as abrupt and as abrasive as Charles, that gives people a reason to get on you even more and to start to dislike you.
As bad as things were, they would only get worse. Frustrated fans looked to Barkley for answers, and unable to provide one, he could only echo their anguish.
Charles is frustrated, he's upset because his players are not giving him the ball.
His plight would hit bottom in New Jersey. Angered by heckling fans, he would spit into the crowd, and unwittingly hit a little girl.
That was a bad time for me. I mean, I ain't lying. I didn't think I was gonna make it then. I will truthfully admit that. I thought I was gonna go crazy because everybody in the world was against me then, and rightfully so. So the spin incident is where it all changed. It made me really like take a closer look at myself. But the most important thing it did was it made me realize that I wanted to win too bad. There shouldn't be anything on a basketball court that make me want to spit on another person. And that's kind of where it all changed for me.
Charles knew he needed to change, but stuck in Philadelphia, he would not be given the chance. Besieged by questions about his character, his leadership, and even his ability, Charles could only stoically bide his time.
You want to stay with this team?
I just want to win, man.
Charles, you want to stay here?
Finally, after a year and a half of waiting, he would be given the opportunity that he craved.
Charles Barkley, he has talked long and hard and loud about his hunger for an NBA title. He was traded to the Phoenix Suns in a 3-for-1 deal. The trade, Charles
now faced the defining test of his career. The Suns offered him what he wanted most, a second chance. But he knew also that if he failed, it would probably be his last. Before Charles could meet his destiny in Phoenix, he would join the dream team for the Summer Olympics. And from the start, his trip to Barcelona seemed to renew his spirits.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We'd like to welcome you aboard. This is...
Glad to be here.
It meant a lot to me because they were saying, hey, you're a great player and you've done a hell of a job, even though your team hasn't been winning. So that was great.
Reaffirmed as one of the game's top stars, Charles again found himself in the midst of adoring fans.
It was like traveling with, the Beatles, you know, that stuff you see on TV, where there's thousands and thousands of people waiting all the time. It was unbelievable.
While some Olympians may have found the constant crowds and attention daunting, Charles took to the streets with relish.
I'm in the Olympics. I wanted to see it. I mean, it's a once-in-a-lifetime thing. I'm not going to spend the whole time in my hotel room. I think that's crazy.
One of the game's most visible figures, Charles attracted the media in droves, and he entertained them like the Charles of old.
People usually go after the guy who's the most vocal, and he didn't disappoint anybody. He was in rare form.
How much do you know about Angola, the guy that you would be playing there? And
I don't know anything about Angola, but Angola's in trouble.
How did you feel in 1972 when the Soviet Union beat the United States in that wild game?
Well, I had just flunked my entrance exam into kindergarten, so I really, that was the only thing, you know.
Charles was once again enjoying his celebrity status. And, at the same time, he reveled in being a part of a team where he was not the only focal point.
David Robinson, Pat Ewing, Michael Jordan. This is like us.
Charles, what are you doing, lying again?
Spring break in the ghetto. It was kind of just like hanging out at a big fraternity party.
Come on, man, put your bowling ball here.
Hey, that was a good joke. Did you do that too?
I did.
Sometimes I dream that he is me. I just want to be like Chuck. I mean, Mike. Isn't this fun, Mom?
Relieved of the burden of carrying a losing team, Charles was also having fun sharing the court with his superstar teammates.
Charles is on the run again. Behind it.
Wow. Holy mackerel. I just do my thing. They gonna make me look good. I'm gonna make them look good. Because if you're a great player, man, the game is so easy. And the better players you play with, the game is even easier.
Charles, these guys were so nice and friendly, and they were patting each other on the back, commending you all.
Is it hard? They could have beat by 40 points.
But is it hard for you
nice
to turn?
Nice guys finish last.
And as the dream team swept to its ultimate goal.
They have, as expected, won the goal here in Barcelona.
Charles could just relax and enjoy.
I think there was never really any doubt we were going to win the gold medal. We took the gold medal for granted, but the whole Olympic experience was just fun for me.
Though Charles's triumphant Olympic performance had served notice that he retained his distinctive flair, he arrived in Phoenix facing heavy scrutiny. The Suns hoped that Charles would transform them from a perennially good team to a championship contender. But the questions that had arisen in Philadelphia had them nervously wondering whether he could handle the challenge.
I remember when we made that trade, people were skeptical about that. He said, well, a conservative community like Phoenix, how are they going to accept Charles Barkley?
We're like everybody else. We knew what you read in the paper or what you hear. And I think everybody was a little, you know, anticipating maybe the worst.
Though the pressure on Charles could hardly have been greater, he faced it without ever letting it affect him.
You know, when I first came to Phoenix, I'm going to be myself. I don't really worry too much about what other people think.
From the first day of training camp, he challenged his teammates. I remember one of the first things he did in a practice was he just hammered Cedric Ceballos. He wanted to see how everyone was going to react to that.
I just thought that was unnecessary, uncalled for. I let him know, and you know, we got into a little verbal battle out there on the court. His reason for doing it was basically trying to see who was going to speak up and who would go to war and who would support their teammates.
I think everybody started to see that, you know, there's only 12 of us. We need to have all 12 going in the same direction and going towards the same goal. And he brought the team a lot closer by doing that.
With his new teammates now firmly behind him, Barkley was ready to take Phoenix into the 1993 season.
Here comes Sir Charles Waddle. Blocked from behind by Barkley. My, oh my, where did he come from?
Barkley, nice spin move.
Oh, you talk about power.
As he had in Philadelphia, Barkley would now put his personal imprint on his team.
If you're getting a loose ball and you're close, he'll tell you, get the hell out of the way. This is my ball.
A three for Marley that won't fall. Tipped in the air, there's Barkley.
If the ball is up for grabs and Barkley is anywhere near it, it's Charles.
He absolutely thinks he's the best player on the floor and that he knows more than the referees. You know, nobody should stop him.
Here he comes again.
And here comes Charles. Don't get in his way.
He brought that role of being Mr. Big Tough Guy all the time, making sure that everybody knew that, you know, when the Suns are coming to town, it's a possibility of you getting blown out, getting your butt kicked or whatever. I mean, everybody's starting to put their shoulders up higher, their heads high, and walking with that arrogance.
The Barkley-led Suns would take the NBA by storm as Charles continued to surprise his teammates.
Beautiful pass, Barkley spotted Barley.
I really knew he was a great player, but I didn't know he was the all-around player that he is.
Barkley, and look out, here comes Phoenix. Oh, look at that pass.
Oh, my goodness.
I didn't realize he could shoot the ball from three-point range.
McGill bounced to Charles, 4-3, got it. Beautiful shot, Charles.
I didn't know he was a good shot blocker.
Oh, what a block!
I mean, he's won probably three or four games just by blocking shots at the end of the game.
Yeah, 8 seconds to play. Here's the drive. It's blocked by Barkley. Saved by Marley, and he's fouled with 3 seconds to go. Barkley made the block. Barkley made the block. Oh, brother. 3 seconds left in the game.
It was just an unbelievable feeling to be on a good team with good guys. And it's just fun when you win. It's that simple.
Barkley was once again lighting up arenas with his unabashed love of the game. And the skepticism that had greeted him in Phoenix now turned to celebration.
And they should be.
He has charisma. He brings people to him. How many guys have a writer following them around and all he does is the Barkley beat? Only a couple quotes from Barkley. He doesn't cover the story, the pregame stories or anything. He does the Barkley beat.
Without question, he's the most popular athlete ever to wear a Phoenix uniform in any sport, and he accomplished that in 1 year.
Barkley's revitalization was not only big news in Phoenix, but also throughout the league.
He carries on a press conference before every game. You know, he'll have a half an hour press conference with the media in every city.
Charles's popularity had never been greater. Now the player who had been the league's most notorious villain was its most celebrated star.
Charles Barkley!
Wait a minute. What's going on here? Some fan ran out on the court, and Barkley's getting some smooches.
I'm surprised that wasn't one of my daughters the way they love Barkley.
I think it started with the Olympics. I think that brought me to the forefront. But in the last year or so, man, it just kind of all just like, boom.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the man we all know and love, Charles Barkley!
Action. Check this out.
No matter how much success you have, every time you go to the next level, it's still mind-boggling.
But no matter how high Barkley's popularity skyrocketed, he never lost sight of his goal.
Money doesn't matter, endorsements don't matter. All that matters is winning.
And win is what he would do. He would lead the Suns to the most victories in franchise history and garner for himself the game's highest individual honor.
You led your team in assists, you led them in rebounds, you led them in points, and you led them to the best record in the NBA. The fans here and around America, join me in congratulating you, Charles Barkley, the 1992-93 National Basketball Association Most Valuable Player. Congratulations.
Charles had completed his remarkable resurrection with a flourish.
Charles's teammates now are bowing down to him.
But it was clear that Charles's most important test lay ahead of him. That had been obvious from his first day in Phoenix.
When Charles came in, and I showed him the arena, the new arena here, I said, Charles, you see this beautiful, magnificent building? It was all built without your services. I took him into the arena. See all these seats? They will be full. And I want you to know something, Charles. You didn't put one person in the seats. Every seat was sold out before you ever got here. Now, look up there. What don't we have? Championship flag. That's what we want from Charles Barkley. If you don't bring that championship to us, then don't be telling us what you did for us.
The card passed to Worthy. He might score it himself. Slam dunk!
But as the playoffs began, it looked as if Charles's inspirational season was going to end embarrassingly short of expectations.
And the Los Angeles Lakers go home one victory away from knocking out the winningest team in the NBA. Oh my.
We're down 0-2, and I know the next question is, are you guys dead? No, we're going to win the series. We're going to win one Tuesday, and the next game's Thursday. We'll win there, then we'll come back and we'll win the series on Sunday. And everybody will say what a great series it was.
Westfall had made the guarantee, and now Charles would shoulder the burden of making good on it.
Hey, sir, we got to put it together, guys.
Let's win. We got to win tonight. That's simple. Let's show up.
So you're always nervous, but it's not a nervous scare. It's nervous, like, what can I do now?
What he would do was to lead one of the most dramatic comebacks in playoff history, as he simply refused to let the Suns be defeated.
They're fighting for their life, led by Charles Barkley.
Charles makes everybody's job so much easier because he takes such a burden on himself. He's the superstar of the team. He is willing to take that responsibility for wins and losses.
Leading the Suns to two straight victories in Los Angeles, Charles returned to Phoenix ready to fulfill Westfall's prophecy. And though the Lakers put up a bitter struggle, Charles finished them off with a relentless determination.
In overtime, Phoenix advances.
Barkley's next challenge came in the person of San Antonio superstar David Robinson.
The baseline gets in underneath. A lot of traffic, though. He's going to lose the ball. Dives for it. Finally picks it up. Here's his fadeaway. He got it! He wouldn't give up on it.
With Barkley and Robinson battling to a standstill, the series remained deadlocked through four games. But it would be in the fifth game that Barkley would face the Spurs' stiffest challenge.
In game five, I probably played my best game of my life. We were down the whole game. And I scored 20 points in the fourth quarter, and it was just unbelievable.
Barkley now comes in underneath, reverse layup, won't go. He battles for the rebound, follows and scores. Robinson tries to jam it, and it's blocked by Barkley, the defensive gem of the night. Here he comes, there he goes. Those are the big plays the Suns need. Needs on the drive, he'll follow. No! Barkley's there, he'll put it up. Oh, what a shot! Oh, my goodness! He has been a terror here in the fourth quarter. What a game! Follow some credit.
Nothing personal. I don't mean to brag, but can't no one person stop me. But don't take that personal.
Game six would again turn on Barkley's personal battle, as the Suns again looked to him for last-second heroics.
It's time to go to work with Chuck. KJ will be up. We got three-point shooters spotted. Bring Chuck right to the ball. Chuck, you go to work.
Yeah, I got the best.
He wants the ball. Charles wants the ball in every pressure situation there is.
Robinson on Barkley. It's his game to win. 20-footer, yes, with 1.8 seconds, Charles Barkley.
I'll take any shot, anytime, anywhere. Somebody got to be the hero. Might as well be me.
In the conference finals, the Seattle Supersonic strategy was a simple one. Stop Barkley, and you stop the Suns.
Barkley takes it inside, keeps coming, goes to the hoop. He's knocked down. No whistle, no harm, no foul.
Double and triple teaming him, Seattle worked to frustrate Charles. But his fiery determination was undimmed.
He's got to shoot it. He goes in, knocked down. Marley follows and scores. Well, the Suns just didn't give up on it.
I mean, he might fail, but he's not going to fail because he's not giving it a shot.
Charging over and around Seattle's swarm of defenders, Barkley carried Phoenix to a 3-2 lead. And within one victory of his first final.
I remember last year we played in Seattle in the
in the sixth game, you know, he put on his joy. You know, I think that Pat and Tate, you know, had us listening to that. He goes out there and he doesn't have a good game. Doesn't play. He plays hard, but he was playing hard and he was hurting us, though, as he always said.
Barkley blocked by Perkins. Boy, what a scramble! Barkley pulled the tip, doesn't score.
This is one that you can definitely pin on me. Oh, it's a difference in the game. It's not often when a guy who's supposed to win the game for you blows it for you. But you take the good with the bad.
You know, I wasn't feeling too good because you never know what's going to happen in a situation. Because someone could have gotten hurt, he says, hey, don't worry about it. He says, don't worry about it. Yep, we gave that game to him. He says, I did anyway. He says, don't worry about it.
Barkley again faced the end of his finals quest. And again, he would rise to the challenge.
At that point, I'm saying to myself, I just got to play the best game of my life, and I'm going to the finals.
Frank Johnson comes up with a loose ball. The Suns on the run. Give it to Barkley. Wham! Oh, that's all they needed. Barkley. Bam, bam, slam. Here's the man going to work. Gets the double team. Oh, my. Said, don't get in my way. Attention. Attention, Chicago. He takes it to the iron. And this is it. Gets two rebounds. Barkley. He's everywhere.
And that's what happens when you got your game on. Has come to play tonight.
You know, in that seventh game, I think he had 44 points, 25 rebounds. And he said, Frank, I told you not to worry about it.
And the Phoenix Suns are in the NBA Finals in quest of their first ever NBA championship.
That was a perfect example of his will to win. He was not going to allow us to lose that game.
Charles' long-awaited trip to the championship series was finally at hand. His journey had been an arduous one, but now at last, he would lead his team into battle for basketball's ultimate prize.
We are the best team in the world. Let's go, baby. Let's
win. Ironically, he would face the Chicago Bulls, the team that had started his spiral in Philadelphia so long ago. But this time, he would not be defeated easily. And even as the Bulls jumped out to a 2-0 series lead, Charles remained steadfast in his belief in himself and his team.
Kevin Johnson, and here is the Bulls.
To the Phoenix fans who were getting on Kevin tonight, if Kevin Johnson, we wouldn't be here without him. And if you're going to boo Kevin Johnson or give him a hard time if he's struggling, please don't come to the game, because we don't need you. If you're not going to be with us through the good times and the bad times, we don't want you here.
He is with his team, win or lose, good or bad. And he stood up and he was counted.
He puts nothing ahead of his teammates. And I think that's a great quality that he has. And he knew that if he stepped up and said something nice about KJ and that we're still behind him, that people would step back and listen to him because of who he is.
He had seen his team in Philadelphia dismantled. Now in Phoenix, he would hold his team together.
Charles has come to play, and he's come to lead his team. He's putting them on his shoulder saying, I'm going to lead you. Everybody follow me.
Though Barkley would ultimately come up short in his cherished quest, he would never stop fighting.
That's a superstar. That's a leader. And he wants a championship.
And though the Suns would not fulfill their championship expectations, Barkley would not let their spirit be broken.
We played as hard as we could. Can't do no more. I'm proud of my team.
I have to give all the respect to the Phoenix Suns for fighting back, fighting back. They really play a championship basketball.
I expected us to win the world championship this year. I mean, I expected it all the way. I don't really think we came away empty. I think that we gave it all we had. We played as hard as we could, and that's all anybody can ask of you.
You kind of actually caught between a rock and a hard place, because you want to say it was a great year, but you feel so bad right now.
In your job and in whatever you do in life, if you can honestly say you did the best you could, I think that's all that matters.
I don't think anybody can ever say they did had a year like I've had it. If we had a one, that would have been a capper.
He wants it real bad, and he does have it in perspective. If he doesn't get it, his life's not going to end because he doesn't get it. But when he's out there competing, he probably feels like it's going to end if he doesn't get it.
I don't look at myself as like a failure because we didn't win the world championship. You know, hey, if we're on a team good enough to win it, we'll win it. If we're not, we won't win it.
Like the protagonist of many heroic stories, Charles has come full circle. But despite all the changes he has gone through, he still seems to inspire endless attempts to define him.
Charles is the epitome of the conservative ideal, of a guy who never asked for anything, who overcomes odds, goes out and competes, doesn't make excuses, doesn't whine. He just has made a success out of himself.
Opinions and perceptions change, but Charles is so enduring. I think anybody that knows Charles Barkley, it's very difficult not to like him.
He loves life. He loves the game. He's always smiling, even after bad games. He's just a guy that loves sports, loves his job, and makes everyone else's job a lot more fun.
Perhaps he is such an intriguing subject because he has never been particularly worried about making himself clear. Except, of course, to the one person with whom he has always managed to come to terms with, himself.
You know, people think you're trying to be this and that. I'm not, I mean, what I'm fine with, somebody asks you a question, you tell them the truth. I mean, and if I had a chance to do it all over again, maybe I would have just said what they want me to say. But I'm proud of myself because I didn't, because you should be able to be honest. That's it, simple.
Watch this. Ooh. That's what I'm talking about. The ultimate entertainer.